Hello guys, today we'll be doing the facial nerve, yes I've gone. So the facial nerve is quite complicated, but I'm going to try to break it down as simple as I can, and then I'll try by all means to keep the video as short as possible. So before you can even check out this video, you must have checked out all the branches of the trigeminal ganglion we did, because they all contribute towards some of the branches of the facial nerve. So if you didn't understand those videos, it will be difficult for you to follow. So I'll put the links on the description below, and then don't forget to like and subscribe. Then after this video, I'll upload the maxillary nerve, and then from there we'll go to the lateral face. So without wasting time, guys, what you have to understand is always you must start at the origin, right? So the origin of the facial nerve, what you have to understand is that it has four nuclei, right? But before going to the nuclei, it has a couple numbers of fibers, right? So it has sensory fibers, it has parasympathetic fibers, and then it has motor fibers. So it is quite complicated, because if you remember quite well, with the trigeminal nerve, we only had two fibers, the sensory and the motor. Although we had the parasympathetic here and there, but the parasympathetic were not part of the nuclei, right? So with the facial nerve, it is quite different. So without wasting time, as I said, it has four nuclei. The first one is the facial nerve nuclei, right? So the facial nerve nuclei, it's funny in that all the fibers, we know that they should go from the brainstem, then they should come anterior and exit the brainstem to either foramen that they should exit to, right? But with this nucleus, what's funny about it is that before it can even go to the front, it first goes backwards, right? And then it turns. So if you remember quite well, the reason why it does that is because we have a nucleus there. I don't know, let me use this color, yeah. We have a nucleus there. That nucleus is for cranial nerve number 6. So it goes around that nucleus, and then it will form this bumpy prominence here, which we call facial calculus, right? So the reason why it goes at the back is because it goes around the cranial nerve number 6, right? And from there, what will happen is that we come and exit the brainstem through the pontomedullary junction. Remember, this is your pons and this is your medulla. So right where they meet, we call that the pontomedullary junction, right? So this, the blue one, is your facial nerve, right? I'm going to explain what is this I drew here. And then from there, you have the other nucleus, which is the second one. As you can see, I drew someone who's crying and they're even lacrimating at the same time. So that will be the function of that nucleus, right? It will supply the lacrimal nerve and some of the taste fibers, right? But not necessarily taste, because taste is for this one, right? But it will make sense by the end of this video. I'm going to explain how these two are related. So what is this nucleus? This is your superior salivatory nucleus. So remember I said in anatomy, the moment you have superior something, you should always bear in mind that you have inferior. So if we have superior salivatory nucleus, it means we also have inferior salivatory nucleus, but we won't discuss the inferior salivatory nucleus in this video, because the inferior salivatory nucleus is for cranial nerve number 9, right? So this is the superior salivatory nucleus. So the superior salivatory nucleus is responsible for innervating the lacrimal gland and the nasal gland, the palatine gland, the mucous glands, and everything. But the major one that we are going to discuss in this video is the lacrimal gland. And then it also supplies the sublingual and the submandibular glands, right? So from the brainstem, it will also exit the brainstem through the pontomedullary junction, right? But what's fun is that it will, this is not a kernel of any sort, it's just a bundle, right? I will tell you what's the name of that bundle and why they call it. It's not a kernel, bear in mind. So with that being said, the other nucleus, we are familiar with the red nucleus. We talked about it when we spoke about the, when we were discussing the trigeminal nerve. So the name of that nucleus is the spinal sensor of the trigeminal nerve, right? And if you remember quite well, is that the spinal nucleus has what it has, the pain and temperature fibers. It has some of touch and everything, but the main ones is the pain and temperature, right? So it will also move from there, its fibers will move, and then they will also move along with the parasympathetic fibers from this superior salivatory nucleus, right? And another thing, as much as the superior salivatory nucleus has more than one function, we only have one fiber here. So they will only divide when they get there. I'll explain how, right? And then from there, the last nucleus we have is the nucleus tractus solitarius, right? So that is our fourth and last one. This one is mainly for taste. So anything that has to do with taste has to pass through that nucleus, right? So you have your cranial nerve number 7, which is the facial nerve we are doing right now. You have cranial nerve number 9. It also has the tractus solitarius nucleus. It also originates from there. And lastly, you have your cranial nerve number 10, right? But you're not doing those ones, but I'll show you how they are related to that one. So by the time we do the tongue, it will be easier for you to follow, right? Then from there, it will have its fibers moving along with the superior, the fibers of the superior salivatory and the spinal sensor, right? So if you can see, okay, this is your fourth ventricle, it's not important for now, but I just drew it for orientation, right? So the facial nerve, all of these four fibers of a facial nerve, but at this level, we give them separate names, right? So this one is the facial nerve or the facial proper, right? They divide them into two components. This facial proper is your motor component. And then all of these three, they are your sensory component. And this black thing I drew here is just to represent the bundle. And the name of the bundle that contains all these three fibers is called the nervus intermedius, right? So the question you should be asking yourself is why they call it intermedius, because we know intermedius is from the word intermediate, which means in between. So it is in between what? It is in between cranial nerve number 7 and cranial nerve number 8. Because if you remember quite well, cranial nerve number 7 and cranial nerve number 8, they both exit through the same foramina, which is the internal occipital meatus, which is what we're going to discuss in a minute, right? So without wasting time, just bear in mind that the motor component is called the facial proper and the sensory component is called the nervus intermedius. But the nervus intermedius, although it is a sensory component, just bear in mind that it has parasympathetic fibers, right? It has parasympathetic fibers. So I will discuss the course of each nerve separately so that I don't confuse you guys. So let's carry on. The facial nerve proper, right? This is facial nerve proper. It will move from the posterior fossa, posterior cranial fossa, and then it will enter this foramina here. What is this foramina? The internal occipital meatus, right? Internal occipital meatus. So I'll just abbreviate it with IA, right? So this is the internal occipital meatus. So after entering the internal occipital meatus, it will give off branches that will form this round purple thing I drew here. So what is that? That is your geniculate ganglion, right? That is your geniculate ganglion. So the reason, or the easiest way to remember the name of this geniculate ganglion, is you think of the weight genu. So you should remember that when it comes to anatomy, the weight genu means knee-like, right? So this bends, this canal bends, so it bends like the knee. So the ganglion there, they will call it the geniculate ganglion, right? So this ganglion is not a parasympathetic ganglion. So these fibers won't stop, they just pass through, right? They just pass through. And then they will move along. And one thing again, this cube structure I drew here, this is your middle ear. So your middle ear is shaped like a cube. It has the posterior wall, this is the posterior wall, this is the roof, this is the floor. This side, it's your lateral side, and then that side is your medial side, and then you have your anterior side. So what happens is that the internal acoustic meatus will come, and then it will end where? At the antero superior border of the middle ear. So why am I saying antero superior border? Because I just said this is the anterior part and that is the medial part, but it is at the superior part, right? So it is anterior superior. It is anteriorly, but it is superior, right? Awesome. Then from there, from this geniculate ganglion all the way to there, this is now called the facial canal, right? It is known as the internal acoustic meatus. But once it curves and it goes that way, it is called the facial canal. So the facial proper will go through the facial canal. And then when it gets to that level there, it will give off a branch to this red muscle I drew here. So what's the name of that red muscle I drew? That is your stapedius, right? So your stapedius holds your stapes bone. What is your stapes bone? It is the bone of the middle ear. Remember, we have three, right? So the first one, it is your stapes, right? The other two, we'll discuss them when we do the ear in specifically when you're doing the ear, we'll discuss the other two. So just to avoid confusion, just know that the facial proper will give off a branch to the stapedius, and the stapedius is the one which is holding the stapes, right? And then one other thing you should remember is that on the lateral wall of this middle ear, we have what we call the tympanic membrane, right? So when it comes to hearing and everything, for your stapes bone not to move excessively, it is controlled by this stapedius, right? So the stapedius is innervated by what? By facial proper. Awesome. Then from there, the facial proper will continue. Then it will exit the cranial cavity through a foramina that is between styloid. This is my styloid bone. This is my mastoid. So it's your styloid process, mastoid process. It will exit between these two. So this foramina, it will be called the stylomastoid foramen. It is because it is between styloid process and the mastoid process, right? So it will exit between the two, and the name of the foramen will be the stylomastoid foramen. Then when it exits there, it will give off its first branch that will supply the muscle behind the ear. So this branch is called what? Posterior auricle. I'll just write PA, right? It's your posterior auricular. It will innervate the muscle behind the ear. And what is that muscle behind the ear? It is the posterior auriculus, right? And then it will give off another branch, right? That will go and supply two muscles. One will supply the posterior digastric, right? Remember that the digastric muscle has two portions, right? It has the anterior portion and the posterior one. And the anterior one is innervated by cranial nerve number 5. We discussed it. So check out the videos again. And then the posterior one is innervated by cranial nerve number 7. So it will innervate the posterior dicastric. Posterior dicastric, and then it will also innervate what the stylohyoid. I will write SH. It will innervate the stylohyoid. And then you must bear in mind that both the posterior dicastric and the stylohyoid, they are both suprahyoid muscles. We are going to discuss them when we are doing the neck, right? But for now, just know this, and it will be easier for you when we are doing the neck to follow along, right? So the posterior digastric and the sternohyoid, right? And then from there, it will also give off the last branch that will go through the parotid gland. This is your parotid gland, right? And then you must bear in mind and remember that this nerve, the facial nerve, it's not supplying the parotid gland, it just pierces through it. And this facial nerve divides the parotid gland into the deep and the superficial lobes, right? We are still going to do the parotid gland. So when it gets there, it will, inside the parotid gland, it will form 5 branches, right? So you must know the names of these 5 branches. So the easiest way to remember the names of these 5 branches is if you use the mnemonic that says 2 Zulu boys must cry, right? So that 2 Zulu boys must cry, first letter of each will help you to remember the branches of this facial nerve. So 2 Zulu boys must cry. So the first T is for the temporal branch, right? That will supply the orbicularis oculi and the corrugator supercilium. If you didn't check out those, check the video on the anterior face. We did those, right? So 2 Zulu. So the Zulu, the Z is for the zygomatic. The zygomatic will also innervate the orbicularis oculi. Just because it is zygomatic, it doesn't mean it will innervate the zygomaticus major and minor. It won't. The zygomaticus major and minor are innervated by the following branch, which is your buccal branch. Don't confuse the buccal branch of facial nerve with the buccal nerve of the, which is a branch of the mandibular nerve of trigeminal 5, right? Not of trigeminal 5, of cranial nerve number 5. Right, so the buccal branch and the buccal nerve function differently. The buccal nerve is mainly sensory, whereas the buccal branch it is motor, right? And then the other branch is 2 Zulu boys must. That's your marginal mandibule. Don't just say mandibular because it runs along the margin of the mandible, right? Then the last one is your cervical branch, which will innervate what? Your platysma, because cervical you think the neck, so your platysma is at the neck, right? So those are the 5 branches of the facial nerve, right? So that is your facial proper. We are done with the facial proper. Then going to the next branch, which is your parasympathetic branch, which is from the superior salivatory nucleus. Superior salivatory nucleus, it will also enter the internal acoustic meatus, right? And then also when it gets to the geniculate ganglion, it won't synapse, because I said the geniculate ganglion is not a parasympathetic ganglion, and this fiber is parasympathetic. But remember that this fiber is carrying fibers for 2 separate things, your lacrimal gland and for your salivatory gland, right? So you know that saliva, it has to do with the tongue. Then lacrimal has to do with tears. So the tongue and the eye, they are at 2 separate places. So they have to divide when they get at this level. Not that they synapse, they just divide. It's like the fiber branches into 2, right? So I will discuss the first branch being the one which will go to the lacrimal gland, right? So when it gets there, it will ascend and then it will enter the medial cranial fossa, right? So this here will be your anterior. This will be your anterior cranial fossa. This will be your medial, and then this one will be your posterior, right? So it will enter the medial cranial fossa, and then after it will exit through foramen lacerum, right? When it exits through foramen lacerum, it will meet another branch. Where is that another nerve from? It is from the internal carotid artery nerve plexus, right? So remember that plexus is just another way forward for a network of nerves. So the internal carotid, this is your internal carotid artery, right? So your internal carotid artery has a plexus of nerves, a network of nerves surrounding it. So it will form a branch that will move from there, right? And then it will meet with this branch, and then they will form one branch, and they will move through this canal. But before you can even discuss what will happen from there, you have to know that these are parasympathetic fibers, but the moment they divide, the moment these lacrimal fibers divide to enter the medial fossa, we call this nerve now what? The greater petrosal nerve, right? The greater petrosal nerve. So the greater petrosal nerve will enter the foramen lacerum, right? And then this branch that is from the nerve plexus of internal carotid artery, it is called the deep petrosal nerve, right? Remember, we also have the lesser. If we have the greater petrosal nerve, we should have the lesser petrosal nerve. And we discussed the lesser petrosal nerve when we were doing the mandibular division, when we discussed the postganglionic fibers that will go to the parotid gland, right? So I'm not going to overcomplicate things for now, right? But check that video again, because soon we will be discussing the parotid gland, and it will be easier for you to follow because I'll be going quickly. I won't be explaining any of the things I said right now, right? So this one will be your deep petrosal nerve, and then it will combine with the greater petrosal nerve. Then together, they will be called the nerve to pterygoid canal. So together, both, when they combine, not really that they combine, but they are just close to each other, right? They are close to each other, but we refer to them as one nerve. So it is the nerve to pterygoid canal, right? The nerve to pterygoid canal. So that nerve to pterygoid canal, that should tell you that they move through which canal? The pterygoid canal. That is just self-explanatory. I'll just write the nerve to PT, right? So this PT is for pterygoid canal. So from the pterygoid, this is your pterygoid canal. This canal is your pterygoid canal. From there, this nerve to pterygoid canal will go to this fossa. What is this fossa? It's your pterygopalatine fossa. We mentioned the pterygopalatine fossa when we were doing the second division of the trigeminal ganglion, which is your maxillary division, right? When it gets there, it will synapse, because all the way it didn't synapse from the brainstem, it has been preganglionic fibers. So when it gets here, it will synapse with the postganglionic fibers. So those postganglionic fibers, and what is this ganglion? Since it is in the pterygopalatine fossa, this is the simplest ganglion to remember. It will be called the pterygopalatine ganglion, right? So that these postganglionic fibers will move from the pterygopalatine ganglion. And then what you should remember before I can even continue to make things easy for you, we have this foramen here, foramen rotundum. So if you remember quite well, what goes through foramen rotundum is your maxillary division, right? So your maxillary nerve will enter there. Remember I said it will go beat on the pterygopalatine fossa and then it will exit, then it will move like that, and then it will branch into two, right? It will branch into the zygomatic branch and the infraorbital. Again, if you didn't check this, go back and check the videos. So it will branch into two, the infraorbital nerve and the zygomatic branch. And the zygomatic branch will also itself, it will branch into two. It will branch into the zygomaticotemporal and the zygomaticofacial, right? So it will branch into the zygomaticotemporal and zygomaticofacial. So what will happen is that these branches that are from the pterygopalatine ganglion will jump. Let me erase this. They will jump or hitchhike the zygomatico temporal branch, right? So they will first hitchhike the zygomatic branch and then they will jump onto the zygomatico temporal. Where are they going? They are going to supply the lacrimal gland. So let's say the lacrimal gland is somewhere there. So that's your lacrimal gland. But before they can even go to the lacrimal gland, they have to join a nerve because the zygomaticotemporal nerve is not going to the lacrimal gland. They are just hitchhiking, right? So if you remember quite well, there's a branch and not the V1, right? So this will be V2. And then V1 will also enter through the superior orbital fissure. And then we know that it will divide into three branches, right? It will divide into the nasociliary, into the frontal, and the lacrimal. Now we are just interested in the lacrimal branch. The lacrimal branch will pierce through the lacrimal gland and it will supply the lateral upper lid, right? The lateral upper eyelid. And then this is where these parasympathetic fibers will hitchhike the lacrimal gland, then they will go to the lacrimal gland itself. I hope you understood all of that, guys. And again, it will be easier for you if you first understood the trigeminal nerve, because now if you didn't, this is just a lot to you and it seems like I'm talking gibberish, but it's easy, trust me. So that was just the first branch of this parasympathetic nerve. So the second branch, we are done with the lacrimal gland. The second branch we said is going to the salivatory. So it's going to the submandibular and sublingual glands. So from there, another branch will go through the facial canal. And then because it can exit the cranial cavity, because I mean the glands, those glands are not here, they're here. So it has to take another route and come anteriorly. So it will exit through a foramen there. What is this name of the foramen? Since it is in the posterior wall of the middle ear, it is called the posterior canaliculus. So it will enter that foramen and it will come anteriorly and exit through the foramina that is found on the anterior wall. So the name of this one will be called the petrotympanic fissure. Petrotympanic fissure, right? So I'll just write PTF, right? So your petrotympanic fissure. And then this one is the posterior canaliculus. You won't forget that group. So it will come, but it won't go alone. It has to hitchhike as well. Because remember that when we were doing the mandibular division, we discussed that the lingual nerve will be joined by the nerve that is a branch of facial nerve. And then we said the name of that nerve was what? Caudal tympani. And then it will supply what? The taste on the anterior two-thirds of the tongue. So it will require a branch, right? So this is foramen ovale. So your cranial nerve, not your cranial nerve, your V3 of cranial nerve number 5, which is your mandibular division, will enter the foramen ovale. And then we know that it will divide into two divisions. We have the anterior division and the posterior division. So the posterior division, some of the branches of the posterior division will be the lingual nerve. So the lingual nerve will go to the anterior two-thirds of the tongue. Anterior two-thirds of the tongue. Then what will happen on the anterior two-thirds of the tongue? It will give general sensation. When we're talking about the general sensation, to be specific in this case, the lingual nerve will give off sensation for pain, temperature, and touch, right? So touch, pain, and temperature. So this branch, this lacrimal, not lacrimal, sorry, this salivatory branch will join the lingual nerve, but it will then divide, it will not go with it until it reaches the anterior two-thirds. It will move away from it and then it will go through a ganglion. What is the name of this ganglion here? This is the submandibular ganglion, right? Submandibular ganglion. And then from the submandibular ganglion, remember this is also a preganglionic fiber. From here, it will synapse, right? So it will synapse from here, and then it will form the postganglionic fibers that will go to the sublingual because it is below the tongue, and then the other ones will synapse and go to the submandibular, right? But the name of the ganglion is submandibular. It's not submandibular and sublingual, right? So we are done with that. And then going to the third fiber, which is your spinal sensory. So your spinal sensory, as I said, that it is mainly for temperature and touch. So it will also go through the internal occipital. It will pass the geniculate, don't give synapse, go through the facial canal, and then it will only follow the root of the posterior auricula, and then it will give general sensation, to be specific, touch and temperature to the external ear. That's it. That is the simplest. Done with that one. Then going to the last one from the tractus solitarius nucleus. This is the tractus solitarius nucleus. Remember, it is mainly for taste, right? So from the tractus solitarius nucleus, it will also enter the internal occipital meatus. But what's nice about this one is that it is the only one which will synapse at the geniculate ganglion. So when it synapses there, its fibers will continue in the facial canal. They will continue. It will also exit through that foramen, and then it will also exit through the petrotympanic foramen. From there, basically it's like it's following the path of the salivatory fibers. From there, it will go and supply or innervate for taste. Taste where? On the anterior two-thirds of the tongue. So the posterior one-third would be supplied by cranial nerve number 9. And then at the where posteriorly, it will be cranial nerve number 10, but you're not doing that today. So this will give sensory innervation for taste, right? So the two of these, this lacrimal this salivatory branch and this branch from the nucleus solitorius, the two of these, that is called your caudal tympani, the caudal tympani branch, right? So with that being said, and then one other thing you should remember is that this lacrimal, the branch that these parasympathetic fibers that gives innervation to the lacrimal gland, it will also give innervation to the nasal gland. It will also give innervation to the palatine gland. It will also give innervation to the mucous glands. So it's not just the lacrimal gland, but to keep the video easy and to make it easier for you, just remember the lacrimal gland, but it also gives off others, because you can't cry without releasing mucus and everything, right? So all of those things, they are just a bundle, right? So with that being said, guys, I think I discussed every single thing you have to know about the facial nerve. It is one of the most complicated cranial nerves. So you must remember that it has how many fibers? Three. It is sensory, parasympathetic, and motor fibers. And then it has four nuclei. The blue one I drew here is that is your facial nucleus or motor nucleus of facial nerve. And then the green one, that is your superior salivatory nucleus. Then this red one, that is your spinal sensory of nucleus of trigeminal nerve. Then this orange one is your rectus solitorius nucleus. And then it is for taste. Then all of these three fibers except the facial nerve, they will all go together and then they will form a bundle which is called nervus intermedius. So they will all enter the internal orchestral meatus. But the only ones that will synapse with the geniculate ganglion, it's your the fibers from the rectus solitarius, right? And then you know that the facial proper will give off a branch to the stapedius, then it will continue and branch into the posterior auricula, supplying the posterior ear, give off motor fibers to the posterior digastric muscle and the stylohyoid, and then it will go anteriorly and pierce through the parotid gland, divide it into the superficial and deep lobes, right? And then it will give five branches there: temporal, the zygomatic, the buccal, and the marginal mandibula, as well as the cervical branch, right? Then from there, the branches, the parasympathetic branches will divide there. Not that they synapse, they just divide. The lacrimal branches will go, enter the foramen lacerum, and they will meet with the deep petrosal nerve, and then the nerve to pterygoid canal will synapse at the pterygopalatine ganglion. Then from there, it will hitchhike the zygomatic nerve and hitchhike the lacrimal branch. Then it will go to the lacrimal gland, but it's not going to the lacrimal gland only. It's also going to the palatine, to the mucous glands, and all those glands there, right? And then from there, what you have to know is that the other part, the other branch of the parasympathetic is your salivatory branch. So it will go through the facial canal, but it will exit through this foramen here, as well as your fibers from the rectus solitarius. So they will exit there, and then together they are called the caudal tympani, which is the branch of your facial nerve, right? But when they get there, the parasympathetic fibers will go and synapse at the submandibular ganglion. And then the postganglionic fibers of it will go to the sublingual and submandibular glands. Then from there, you have your fibers from the rectus solitorius, which will continue and give taste, innervation, or taste, the sensory part of taste, right, to the anterior two-thirds of the tongue. So with that being said, guys, that is the facial nerve in a nutshell. If you know this, you have mastered the facial nerve, it will be easier for you to follow along when you're doing the lateral phase. Because this, basically, we are doing the lateral phase. but we are just breaking it into smaller chunks. And when we are looking at the bigger picture, it will be easier for you to follow. So with that being said, guys, that will be it for this video. It will be followed by the maxillary artery. Then from there, yeah, we hit the ganglions we find in the anterior face and go straight to the neck, right? Go straight to the neck. And then with that being said, this is it for me, guys. And then, yeah, don't forget to like and subscribe. And yeah, let me know what you think of all this tutoring and everything on the comment section below. That is it for me, guys. I'll see you on the next lesson.